mode and landscape mode. What is really the difference between these two is that in portrait mode you see the logo on the top left and you see the menu on the right top, then you see the score on the left bottom and the controls on the right bottom, right? If it's a landscape, like you rotate your phone, it's going to change the places where you saw the logo and things like that. This game, when I designed, was thought like this. I thought this is how my layout will be and that's how I'll design the game. So for this, I need to write only one code. I'll show this game running on my desktop as well as on my Nexus One, if possible, right now. So this is a typical example of flexible layout. Could everyone get me? Do you have any questions as of now? Cool. So you'll have to weigh your requirements based on all the aspects that I said, right? From what are the audiences, what is your game design, what does your game really require? I'm not saying you need to cut down on the features, but based on all the features, and you need to weigh which one is more important, you need to stick to that, right? Again, I'm asking the question because a lot of people came later on. How many of you have worked on ActionScript 3? Okay, for those who have worked on it, please, this slide will be useful for you. For those who have not worked on it, sleep off for 2 minutes. So, this is a very simple ActionScript. In fact, it's not difficult to understand at all. I'm just setting the scale mode to no scale. I'm asking the Flash player not to scale the content on its own. I want to write my own scaling, whatever logic. Next, I'm aligning the whole thing to top left of the screen. And then I'm writing a simple function which will check for a simple if condition that will determine whether it's a portrait screen or a landscape screen, right? Based on how much is the width, how much is the height. Then I'm actually assigning an event listener. Event listener is a function that gets called when an event is triggered. In this case, the event is resize. So when your application is resized, either when you rotate your phone or either when you resize it manually on the web browser or on the desktop Air application, whenever that kind of event happens, this function is triggered, and inside this function, I'm going to write code that will kind of align my objects on the stage according to a portrait fashion or a landscape fashion. Got it? Cool. So for people who are using Flash professional and writing a Flash project, this is the optimized way to do it. For people who are doing Flex, for people who are writing Flex games, Flex-based games, Flex has something called as constraints. As I said, Flex is also, a lot of Flex libraries are also done in ActionScript. So whatever code that I showed you in the previous screen has already been done, and they call it constraints, and they give you very simple left is equal to 10, top is equal to 5, that kind of simple APIs in your MXML in order to define what the constraints should be. So in that case, when you do that, if you create a game and you have a button on the right bottom and you say right is equal to 10 and bottom is equal to 10, no matter what your screen size is, when you resize the game, it's always going to have 10 pixels on the right and 10 pixels in the bottom. So your button always remains in the right bottom, right? So that's a very simple way of doing it in Flex. But if you're using Flash Professional, this is a very simple logic. Next, coming to how you publish it. When you publish games as web applications, then there's a simple setting in the Publish Settings dialog box where you need to say percent. So it should not be as per pixels, you should not hard put the pixels there, you should say 100%. So when your browser is resized, Flash fits into the 100% of your browser size, thus your multi-screen logic or resizing logic works well. Similarly for Air applications, you can set a constraint of a minimum width and a maximum width, minimum height and a maximum height. So you don't want the game to be overly resized to a very, very small size, so you don't even have space to align things. I'll show an example a little later. So these are the two different ways to set those constraints when you are publishing your Air applications. Then let's come to the device input capabilities. One, you have your desktops, like we already talked about, a variety of input capabilities that you need to address when you write a game. So this is a very simple example of accelerometer. I just import two classes. One is the accelerometer class, one is the event of that accelerometer. I'm just going to do a simple if condition. I'll say if accelerometer.isSupported. If this is true, this is going to be true only when the device supports accelerometer and Flash player supports accelerometer, that is running on the device. Flash player supports it, so if the device also supports it, you're going to get a true there. If I get a true there, I'm going to declare a new object and initialize it. and I'm going to add a simple event listener which will say listen to the update from the accelerometer. So whenever you tilt your phone in whatever axis you want, it's going to get accelerometer update event called. So when the event is called, as you can see, I'm right now accessing three properties inside the function. One is acceleration x, acceleration y, and acceleration z. Got it? Code seems simple. I'm also going to do a simple exercise of this. So then we have the multi-touch gestures. There's only one class called transform gesture event. You just need to import it, and you need to just write one line which is add event listener of transform gesture event or gesture zoom or gesture rotate. So that is going to call your function. In your function, you have the event which is a parameter. The event will have scale x or scale y or rotation. Those will this code, if I run it on any object, so when I pinch and resize something, it's going to get the scale x of how much I have resized. I'm also going to show an example of how this works. Then we also have for phones like these, where you have some hardware keys that says menu, home, back, and all those buttons. We also have methods to override your code and directly write behaviors for these buttons. So if you're in a game, you're playing a game, and you press the back button, you don't want it to go to your home screen of the game. You want to go to the main menu of your game. You don't want to go to the home screen of the phone. You want to go to the main menu of the game. So those kind of overriding actions can be written using the reading the key codes that are supported, right? This is the best approach I recommend if you want to write one code for multiple screens. Always keep your core libraries separate, like updating the score and stuff like that, which has got nothing to do with the UI. It's just to do with the logic of the game and setting the values and writing your game logics. That should be kept in the core code, which should be a separate action script file. It should be a separate class. Then you need to write a smart layouting capability, like what I showed you for Flash professional users and Flex users. You need to write your constraints and resize events and stuff like that, and lay things out in a different way for different screen sizes. And that's what is your smart layout. That's a different layer. So that can hook with your core libraries. And then finally, you have platform specific action script files, which will be different for desktop, web, mobile, and tablets. Right? So what happens here is, if you have a core bug, you just fix it in the core libraries and republish all of them, and it reflects in all your platforms, all your outputs. Right? There's no redundancy, there's no changes that you need to make in multiple code bases. Got it? It's a simple code approach if you're writing Flex projects where you use Flash Builder, and there's something called Flex Library Project. If you create a new library project, you can write your core code there and then create new air projects, web projects, and mobile air projects. Then those things can actually link to the library project to read the core logic of the game. Then you have the Flash Professional and Flash Builder workflow, where you can, for people who have worked on Flash Professional primarily, that's not a coding tool. That has something called as timeline. Hope everyone understand what timeline is. So that has something called timeline, keyframes and stuff like that. So it has something called stage, where you can draw things, draw gradients, create movies, create animations, and convert them to symbols, and use those symbols, reuse them in your games and stuff like that. But Flash Builder is entirely different. For people who have been working on Flash Professional and have been finding it difficult to have a very strong code editor, now Flash Builder, which was Flex Builder before, also supports a code editing capability. So you can integrate these two tools very well and use Flash Builder for debugging your content. And I would like to mention two specific URLs below. tinyurl.com/multiscreen1 and multiscreen2. This particular thing, actually, I've posted a source code of the game that I was talking about right now, which is a multi-screen game. So I've also explained a bit as to how I've written the game and how you can use that source code to understand and build your own games. So you might want to download the free source from there. Next, some very important tips that generally people forget when developing is, I know there's multi-touch, but you don't need to complicate by including 10 finger gestures and all that, right? Use only if necessary, and use the most familiar gestures, because that's what the audience or the users are going to be comfortable with. Then generally, as I said, the PPI also matters a lot when you design. It's not only the resolution of the screen, it also depends on how the physical size is. So based on that, approximately around 45 to 50 pixels should be a range for a touch point, right? That's how you need to keep in mind when you design, especially when you design mobile games and stuff like that, which is generally very tiny in terms of UI. So you need to keep in mind all these aspects. And how many of you know what haptic is? Very few of them. Have you noticed when you click on a touch screen, you see the device vibrating a bit? That's called a haptic. You just need to give the user a feedback that confirms him that you have clicked on a button, right? Either a sound, beep sound, or a haptic, or vibration, or some kind of visual representation. It's always necessary, because I have used some applications and it's extremely irritating if I don't receive the haptic feedback. I don't know whether I pressed the right buttons or not, right? So this is the tool I was talking about, which allows you to test and simulate the things. This is called Device Central. You have hell lot of device profiles, right, from Nokia phones, LG phones, Samsung phones, Symbian phones, Windows mobile phones, Android phones, tablets, televisions, everything. All these kind of devices are created as a profile and they are uploaded to Adobe server, and we constantly keep updating them with the latest devices. So you can download those device profiles and you can test your content on them. You do have a lot of, like you can see a small device is there on the right bottom. That's the accelerometer simulator. So you can click and drag on it to whatever axis you want, and you're going to see the content responding to that. So you can simulate accelerometer right in here. You have a geolocation tab which will allow you to enter your own custom latitude, longitude, heading, speed, all those values, and when you update it, it's going to trigger a geolocation event and your content will respond to that in the simulator. Similarly, we have multi-touch for desktop. Since this tool is for desktop, you can't really use multi-touch on a desktop. So you can hold Alt key and Shift key and simulate the multi-touch and define two different touch points and rotate and resize, and all those testing can be done easily. So that's about the testing part. Then we come to the packaging part, where with one tool, with one code, you can really package it to Windows, Macintosh, Linux. You can also create self-executable .exe files for Windows, .dmg files for Mac, APKs for Android phones, and you also have IPA for iPhones and iPads. So one thing to note is that iPhones and iPads don't run Flash Player, don't run Air. We cross-compile your ActionScript code to whatever native format iPhone or iPad requires to. Right? So you don't need to learn Objective-C, you don't need to scratch your head there. If you know ActionScript, write your game in ActionScript, optimize it pretty well, use one click of a button, get your certificate and all those things, sign your application and publish it to IPA file. We are going to convert your ActionScript application to a native iPhone or iPad application. Understood? So these are variety of platforms to which you can publish. Then you have an interesting feature in Flash Professional that will kind of, I can connect my device to my development environment, and I can actually give my certificate details and say test it on the device and run it on it and debug. Actually, it can connect when you've connected your device, when you publish it, it publishes your FLA file into Swift file, then publishes your Swift file into Air file, then converts it to a native Android installer called APK, then copies the APK to your device, installs the APK on your device, and then runs the application also. So we also have a lot of debugging capabilities where you can run your content on your device connecting your data cable and debug the code that you have written on the devices, right? So these are some optimization tips that are very, very detailed. I don't want to go into it. Then we have the in-market that I was talking about. Intel App Up Store is one store that you can target right now. So you can register in the in-market, upload your games and start putting them on a try or buy basis on the market. So it's a new addition to the Flash platform service, and you are going to see many more marketplaces also joining hands with this. And you can check out the analytics and all that once you have uploaded the content, once the users have started buying and downloading the content. Then this is a typical workflow of your in-market. So you go to the in-market, take the necessary APIs for the in-market. It's hardly